semantically equivalent, but might differ in the structure and the behavior. So the two sentences that you see here, that they have been called Minister Want of something, something, and the other has called the Turkish Infrastructure Minister. So they mean the same. As human, you can see that they are actually parallel of each other. Is this a textual similarity problem? Yes, I mean, two paraphrases have to be textually similar, otherwise they are very unlikely to be paraphrased. But it is not necessarily always the case, because, for example, the paraphrase detection is a kind of a binary concept, whether it is a paraphrase or not. The similarity is essentially measured on a continuous scale in terms of extent of similarity. Also, paraphrases are typically defined, for example, the Microsoft paraphrase formula, which is extensively used in this line of research, is always defined in terms of the sentences. For a similarity, you can define at any level as well. The other very commonly used and very popular task is called textual entailment recognition. So, the way it is defined is that given two text fragments, one is called a text, and another is called a hypothesis, we would like to say that the T entails H if reading T we can infer whether H is likely to be true or not. So it also says that T implies H. What you see here is that T is the three lines of the text. And there are three hypotheses listed. Let's see H1. So H1 says that BMI acquired an American company. If you read the article, then it says that a Houston-based company, Lexcorp, by BMI was purchased. Right? Now we know purchase and acquisition is a related thing. We know BMI has acquired a company, and we know Houston is in America. Right? So from all this knowledge, we can actually say that the first hypothesis is true. Similarly, you can see that the second hypothesis is also true, but third is not, because on the third, we cannot infer from the text. It may be true that BMI is an employer-owned concern, but it is not apparent from the what is mentioned in the text. Actually, we cannot say that. Again, two pieces of text, a textual hypothesis has to be related or similar if they have to entail one, if the team has to entail H, but if again, it is not necessarily the both way around. And other big difference is that textual entailment is a one way relation. So T implies H, but that doesn't necessarily mean H implies T. That's again another difference. The other commonly used application is on plagiarism detection, which is heavily used in the authorship attribution, plagiarism, as you know, is a problem of the copying some text and not giving the authorship attribution. You don't cite a particular paper. So two pieces of text have to be similar to be considered for plagiarism. So they are, this is an indicator, but not necessarily the case. If the second article has cited the previous one or has referred to, then it's not a case of plagiarism. So essentially, the emphasis is on the unauthorized use or unacknowledged copying of the document. So we use similarity as an indicator, but it is not necessarily complete. This is an interesting application about text normalization. How many of you have heard about scanning? So roughly the stemming is the, for all of you, that stemming is the way when a particular word is the stream trimmed to its root form or mechanical form. Similarly, when you want to do it at the phrasal level, what kind of application you want. What you see here, the examples of different job titles which are used in a particular portal, and they want to map each of these into one common standard. Right? For example, the ones that you see at the first column, all of them kind of get mapped to the customer service agent, whereas the ones that are mentioned below get me found in the relationships of different people. So you want to kind of map each of these to the actual entity so that the further processing or paper relationship is done. So this is again a particular task of that, how do you map each of the text in a common standard form. This appears in other contexts such as address normalization. So when we talk about things like Indian addresses, and there are like many different ways of writing our addresses, how do you map each of them to one single entity is a very, very, very relevant problem. So my final example application is the why similarity is important. It's about evaluation of certain natural language processing tasks. So we all know from machine translation, where a piece of text from one language is translated to another. output something in the target language. How we know it is good or bad? So typically the metric that is used is called bilingual evaluation something is used for machine translation, which essentially measures that how much of textual overlap a system-directed translation has with a human-provided reference translation. Right? So for example, what you see here, there is system A, which has said Israeli officials responsibility of airport safety, and the reference translation is Israeli officers are responsible for airport security. So there are certain engram overlaps that happen. So the blue has a way of computing the similarity based on these engram overlaps and with some other additional things. But essentially it is looking into how similar these translations are. Right? Of course, blue incurs more challenges because the reference translations in this case may not be one. There will be multiple translations. Five of us look at the same sentence from Marathi to English. It will be maybe different than what all of them is. Right? So there are additional challenges out there, but I think that's keeping it in the case of that. What is the content level similarity between a system-generated translation and a machine and a human-provided translation? So in all these applications, what we see is that the similarity between two pieces of text is essentially enabler or as the first level of check when we are trying to do something a particular application. So textual similarity has been used in these cases as well as in many other examples. So the idea is that how do you measure the content level similarity? Now, content level similarity can be measured at a very, very high level in two different ways. Right? One is what we call as a lexical similarity or surface level similarity, when two pieces of text look similar in terms of their composition of the words and characters. Right? So that is what we are calling as lexical similarity. Typically, these are lower requirement issues. They are very easy to implement, and we'll see some examples in the later part. The other one is the semantic similarity, which is going one level deeper and saying that whether two pieces of text actually mean the same. They may look different, but they should mean the same. Of course, if they are looking the same, they will definitely mean the same, but are they arguing the same one? Now, these kinds of techniques are typically high on requirement in terms of how to build this system. They require more resources, more large amount of textual corpora to actually build this system. Again, we will see some examples in the subsequent 3-4 slides. The other important consideration that we need to keep in mind when we are talking about text similarity is of the granularity of similarity. So we talked about text could be from a word to a complete or from complete book, right? So words are the smallest possible and the most popular granularity of similarity measurement. And there are many resources have been developed for that in terms of semantic similarity. But when we go from word to text, how do we take that transition? Again, at a very high level, and in terms of summarizing, there are two ways of going from word to text. The first set of techniques are known as the compositional techniques, where the basic idea is that if you have text which are longer than a word, you tokenize them, identify the individual component words. Do pairwise comparisons based on your building block techniques, be it lexical, be it semantic. And then you aggregate the overall similarity or aggregate to obtain the overall similarity. Most of the ingenuity in these techniques, set of techniques, come in the way how do you aggregate this. And that is where some of the application dependent or domain specific knowledges come into play. But typically, there are techniques which kind of teach you that how similar to words are. On the other hand, non-compositional techniques try to obtain a representation of candidate texts first. They try to obtain a candidate text representation maybe in a different what we call as a vector space. And in that vector space, they try to measure the distance between two of the projections of these two texts. Right? Again, if you don't get this, then we'll see some example how we may obtain that. But the basic difference is that whether you are processing at the word level or you are processing at the aggregate level of the entire text. Of course, certain sequences of text may require special handling, such as the names of buildings or enterprises or persons or idioms or quotations may require different things. So, we hope that lexical similarity measures the surface level similarity or the how they do. And of course, the obvious way of measuring is that what we call as a string similarity or string metric measures. But there are plenty of measures have been proposed in this case how to measure the surface error similarity. This particular survey paper by this person, Boma and Kami, gives a very, very good overview of and points us to most of these measures. It's a good reference to have. And they kind of categorize these techniques into like two types of techniques, whether one is operating at the character level and the other is what. So character based techniques such as the longest common subsequences, distance, sharpening, and all these techniques. But the word based ones are like Jacquard similarity, which is measuring an intersection or a union of common words and things like that. Typically, such techniques are used some kind of a morphological preprocessing and stemming before comparison is done. But the major challenge with these techniques, as you can imagine, that they don't take it very semantic or syntactic as well. Right? So it's really at a very shallow level, which is true, but at the same time, these kind of techniques have applications in many domains. For example, the plagiarism that we saw is really operating at the next level. Right? It's the translations have to be same to get 100% score. It is not enough, even if they mean the same. Can be argued, but that's what plagiarism is designed. Similarly, for plagiarism detection also, we look into mostly at the lexical similarity. Moving on to semantic similarity. Semantic similarity are, again, of two types that we will be talking about. The first one is what we call as the knowledge base. The knowledge based semantic similarity measures rely on human created linguistic resources to measure similarity between words. One of the very popular linguistic resource or linguistic network is called as WordMeta, which has been developed by the Bristol University over many, many years by several human experts, where they have defined how the words are organized in terms of the ontological phonemic, right? Whether two words mean the same, whether one word is a part of the other, whether two words are instance of the same type and things of that nature, right? And then, once you have such a rich linguistic knowledge, then you can actually use data and measure the similarity between any two words, right? How far close the two words are, right? What is the depth of the most common ancestor of two words in that tree? Let's call it a tree, right? And so on and so forth, right? So the idea of these knowledge-based semantic similarity measures is that you have these linguistic resources. WordMeta is the most popular example, but of course you can have dictionaries, you can have lists and handcrafted domain-specific taxonomies and things of that nature to actually use. So that's the basic notion of this knowledge-based semantic. So this kind of techniques works good for general English text because of the presence of these kinds of networks. But when we are talking about the domain-specific application, say a healthcare application, lack of such linguistic resources kind of creates problems. Of course, there are more linguistic resources have been created over there. They are getting created, but that's a kind of a cold start problem when you want to start on a new domain and try to apply some kind of semantic related problem. In such cases, this other kind of semantic similarity, which is based on the vector space based method, comes into play. The vector space representation of text, or which is also known as the corpus based technique, the basic idea is that if I have a lot of data, a lot of text documents, I can learn a vector space where similar documents or similar words come close to each other. Right? And this notion of similarity would be defined based on the domains or based on the collection of the corpus. And some of the classical way of doing these kind of things is what we call as the term document matrix, which is a matrix which captures that which terms occur in which documents, and then doing these operations on the existing factorization of singular value composition, and to obtain a space where, again, the basic idea is a similar term should come close to each other. So, TF-IDL and latent semantic analysis are probably have remained standards for many, many years in this space to define vector similarity. As I said, the idea is to obtain a vector space, and once you obtain a vector space, you will be able to obtain these similarities by simple applications of distance measures such as Euclidean or cosine. There has been tremendous progress, as probably many of you know, that in this semantic similarity in the recent time, the application on the basis of the distributional hypothesis, which is probably 50 years old, and which essentially says that words that occur in similar contexts to have similar meanings, has been tremendously leveraged by the large computing capacity that we have and the large amount of data that we have to come up with models which defines very, very effective vector space. Right? What vector is the probably the most popular vector space model, which is on a frame on a large amount of data, and show that has shown that tremendous amount of tremendous insightful applications. I mean, pretty much what Quebec is probably the bystander now these days is what any kind of linguistic processing is done. That's the by defect. Other popular vector space model in this era has been Love from Stanford, FastX from Facebook, which has different methodology in the way they do the model building or at what level they operate. For example, FastX operate on the character based model, whereas WordPress and Dropbox are on world level. But essentially, the idea is the same. You get the word vectors at the end, which are very semantically meaningful, right? And they become your input in the following. Now, most of these techniques do not require any kind of training, any kind of model building. So you essentially take these kinds of techniques and the models which are pre-trained and use in your applications. So there have been several open source and packages which are available today in the internet, which you can just go and use this technique readily, or even these models are publicly available, so you can just readily use and capture it. And they are very easy to use. So many times when we start off by want to do a text similarity problem, the first thing you would like to try that way, that you try quickly how any of these particular want to work or any of the knowledge of similarity feature is working before trying to create any complicated models. And that is what I also did when I started off working on one of these problems, example that I was mentioning about short answer theory. All of us know about this online education system, these portals, this Coursera and Classity and Twitter and all these, right? One reason that, I mean, while they have done a phenomenal job in terms of disseminating content throughout the world, but their assessment mechanism has still remained very clean, right? I mean, they still use the multiple choice questions and things of that nature, because we just don't have the ability to automatically grade when we have answers which are not multiple choice questions. Just don't have it. Right? For example, just look at this thing. What is the goal of a prototype programming problem solving? Or let's take the next example. What is a variable? Right? A location in memory that can store a value. That's the model answer that the teacher has provided. Now, student has written a variable is the location of a computer's memory where a value can be stored or for used by a program. The second one has written a variable can be an integer or a string in a program. So we need to assess that whether how much code these two answers should get with the model. If this is a roughly a similarity problem, if the answer is similar to the model answer, we would like to give high score. If it is not, we would like to give low score. So that's with that approach kind of when we started working on this, we did that. And as I said, we essentially tried a similar approach as the more similarity based techniques, and then tried different kinds of aggregation or the compositional measures on top of it. So the basic idea was that you cannot just take the two pieces of text and try to compute similarity, because the student answer may have written more than the model answer. Right? And in that case, you don't want to penalize it. It can be considered an over answer, but as long as it is capturing the right part of it, you are supposed to grade that part correctly. So that is why we kind of obtain this hypothesis that the pairs of related words which appear in student and model answer are similar, and then try to aggregate that at some level. So we propose the use of these various word similarity measure and design a custom aggregation technique. Getting into the formula, so basically it says that for every word in the model answer, I try to find the highest matching word in the student answer, and then I compute the similarity with all the words in the student answer, and then compute the max out, or take the highest matching similarity, and then I average it over all the words in the model. Very simple, not looking into structure, not looking into semantics, but looking into that word level semantics, and then trying to do an average. Right? And that's what we call it word alignment rate symmetric measure. An alternative is to propose that whether with this symmetric vector, whether we interchange the student answer and the model answer, and try to see that how that works. So when we tried with some kind of a lexical overlap of measures, we tried with some of the word pair-based semantic measure, we tried latent semantic analysis, word vectors of that nature. So what we observed is that the asymmetric techniques work better than symmetric. Now that is something something is very specific to this application, right? This is a case where the student answer has to be evaluated against the model answer and not the other way around, right? That's why we expect to plan we see that there's an every student problem. The other one is that the vector space-based measures typically outperform the rest, which is again known fact because these have been like playing very heavily on large corpora. And finally, while in some of the data sets the lexical measures did not perform well, but we had a reading comprehension data set where the lexical overlap technique outperformed some of the other semantic. And when we analyzed it, we realized that in a reading comprehension, when students are answering, they heavily use lifted text from the passages to answer the question. That is why you can actually find higher extent of lexical overlap between them. So basically the takeaway from here is that there is no one thing that works the best either even inside an application, right? It depends on the nature of the data that you have. So that is something you have to really keep in mind. So you have a lot of armor in your possession. You can really choose depending on the nature of the application. Okay. So, till now the part that I have spoken is where we are kind of giving up. As I said, that given two pieces of text, we wanted to compute the similarity. We did not capture that one thing that I have mentioned in the first slide, which is the reader's view of similarity. Right? That too, we never said that how what a human would have thought about if I had given this text. And that is why we say that these unsupervised measures are not designed to learn from the human notion of similarity. Now, which is a flaw, right? Because, for example, if I look at this short answer trading example, now this is again a very similar example. So, for example, if you look at the first question, what are the main advantages of the object-oriented programming? The model answer is abstraction and reasonability. Student answers are, you can see on your screen. They are very different from what they are doing. But the first answer has completely captured and even more the two notions that the teacher wanted. And the teacher has given 5-1-5. The second one has talked about other things like encapsulation, inheritance, and polymorphism, which did not capture the teacher's view of the similarity. So she did not give full marks, only gave 2.5. Right? Now, how we capture this notion? So there is something going on in this case which we cannot measure unless we know what is there in the context. And that is why we need to, while we say that this kind of techniques and this desiderata, that this should be, the technique should be invariant to the similarities in the input that do not matter and selective to similarities that matter. So that is why we want to learn or design systems which can learn from these examples and try to predict for unseen examples. And that is the basic definition of the supervised learning. Now the supervised techniques have been proposed to learn the similarities and things, for example, in the classical techniques, support vector machines, random forest, gainers, paper, offset, and the whole gamut of classification techniques have been applied. In many cases, built on the unsupervised similarity feature. So you compute word overlap, you compute semantic similarity, which you can compute easily, right, without any anything. And then just feed everything as features to this classical algorithm, this supervised learning algorithm, and try to predict. They work better than the unsupervised techniques. But of course, as recently, neural models have been very popular, they have outperformed everything else that used to happen in the machine learning world. So even in these cases, also neural techniques have been kind of shown much better. So let me just give you a flavor of the two different ways of neural models have been used for text similarity. The first set of model has been, the basic philosophy is that take two pieces of text, pass them through these neural models, LSTMs, RNNs, GRUs, convolutional networks, obtain two vector representations, two latent representations, compute their similarities in that, compare that with the human-given similarity, back-propagate that error, and do that in iteratively to learn a network architecture which gives you the best representations of this. Right? Again, I'm just kind of brushing away all the details, but the basic idea is that obtain vector representations of these pairs of sentences which help you preserve the similarities as the human has been. And that final architecture will help you to do that In this particular case, the authors were doing this over a set of words or sentences. In another case, people have done this on the level of categories, right? So, for example, this job title normalization work that I was mentioning. Now, so challenge or the criticism of these kinds of models have been that people have asked this, are these fixed length vectors capable of capturing word level semantic information irrespective of the length of the sentences? So we are cramming everything into a 300 dimension vector and we are expecting that vector should be captured, right? Now is that really possible? That's one challenge. The other thing is that, do we really do it that way? I mean, when we as human brain, do we process two sentences like that? We try to project and try to simulate? No, we probably look for similarities or words or segments of the sentences to see that two are mapping to each other, right? Essentially, we try to operate at the level of words or components of the sentences so that we can define the similarity factor, right? So the other school of models in the neural network has been proposed to do that, these word level similarities, so you can identify which words correspond to each other and then try to define similarities in terms of them. So that's the other school of models. This has been the basis of the what you know as the attention-based models, where you essentially tell the neural network to that which part of the sentences to actually attend to, then expecting these last state of the illustrations to capture the entire meaning of the sentence. I mean, these illustrations are very good in terms of abstracting large amount of textual information into a vector, but instead of that, can we help it to say that, okay, here are the two pairs which are most important in deciding that whether these two sentences are similar. A girl is wearing a blue jacket and a young girl wearing a pink coat plays something. They are very similar, but the fact that a blue and a pink is actually different, immediately our mind tells that these two are not same, right? And these systems learn, right? And that's why these systems have been kind of quite popular. We tried a similar thing for short answer grading, what we call as using a Siamese bias games. Instead of doing attention, we use another model called Earth Mover Distance, which again is a way of saying that how much a word needs to traverse in the space to arrive at the most similar ones. That's the basic notion. But again, it looks into this word level similarity and some way of pairwise and some way of aggregating them into a ordinal regression layer to obtain finite score. So that kind of follows the same philosophy. I'm probably out of time, but that's essentially the conclusion. A number of unsupervised measures have been existing for capturing these lexical and semantic similarities. They are very easy to use. Anytime you want to do these kinds of experiments, that should be the first thing to try out. Combinations of measures will typically often work better because there are similarities at different levels. And always keep your application in mind, especially when you are trying to do the application as we did for short answer. On the other hand, supervised measures typically be unsupervised measures capture application dependent similarities, but they are extremely heavily dependent on the resource requirement in terms of ontology or training data. I mean, none of these neural network models that people have built, you can build with a handful of documents or small amount of models. Okay, so I'm out of time, so let us stop. Thank you. Okay, questions.
So, generally, you have these word embeddings which are kind of general purpose embeddings and you use them across many experiments. How do you build more complex embeddings? For example, for a sentence, we have to write like a matrix. Similar example was in the case of, let's say, an emoji, where an emoji has certain tags, and now using the tag, you want to create an emoji vector. So, like, how do you model all those complex derived embeddings?
Right, so that just like word to vec, there have been very multiple adaptations or extensions have been proposed on this very popular thing is known as document, which essentially takes the document as a thing and gives you a document representation. Right? There are these models which call the sequence to sequence learning model, where you have given one piece of text and your output is not another word, but rather another sentence. Right? So you can learn this sentence and get input for sequence. And to answer your question, you need to build models to do this. Most neural models, they exist in the cases. If you have a corpus where you really want to try this out, the best way to do that actually take this code and try to build one on your corpus. Now, the reason what UX are more popular is because they are standard building blocks. You can just take this and apply on your data and see how they are doing. But if you really want to build, you have to really have to bring data.
Compare takes
certain things,
certain things.
Yeah, yeah, historical analysis of text has been interesting quite. It's just quite something that I don't know that many people have done that. Even Google has that very interesting example where they did Google Books. They did a time chart, a histogram of the most popular words, and then they showed that how the nature of the words changed in the Second World War or recession. No, you have one model answer. We have one model answer. We try to obtain a similarity measurement based on the sector. Try to predict that. Similarity is for the job day. Compare that with what the human school is. Do that for all pairs of, do that for all the student answers while pairing the same one. There is only one model answer, 20 student answers. Now you have learned a model. You have done the 200 student answers for which you want to predict the score. Because these have not been understood. Now you can use this particular method for architecture to predict the bottom score in our case.
So,
like, that's a very good question. That's a part I actually skipped. Where we had shown that if the model answer changes, then the performance of this technique typically get affected. And that's a practical problem. Because otherwise, if you are always assessing against one model answer, is the performance of the system will be very good. It is something that is not streamlined. At least I have not looked into very carefully. I have observed the problem. There are ways of active ways of solving it, but systematic ways of solving can be perfect. It can be something equivalent to this machine translation example, what I was mentioning, that the file reference translation and one thing that is translation against it. Some of those approaches can be. But it's a very good question.
So, my question was like in the answer table. Like the model answers and the certain answers, and like we can assume that they would be grammatically correct because it's an answer which can be provided after some time. So, what this extraction of noun phrase for both is and then doing a lexical match. Yeah. Lexical. So, would it give a better word than?
That's only what stock automating helps in general. Stock automating is like a simple process, but ultimately, anywhere to
it. So, let's say I already know that I just put out only a keyword. So, should I get a
grammatical? Okay, firstly, the grammatical correctness is something that we don't look into much in this case, whether they are syntactically correct or not. But let's take example of the modularity and abstraction, the object oriented.
So my
would you say that doing whatever you said, right, the noun phrase extraction from this would be helpful? Yeah.
Yeah. Given that even the model answer has quite few words, like we can extract out noun phrases and verb phrases from it, and noun phrases and verb phrases from the student's answer, and then doing a simple.
I am not very sure, we can try that. I am not very sure that, I mean, that's kind of too restricted. Again, it would depend on the nature of the answer. For example, here, the notion of this, how a overloaded function is differentiated by a compiler. The model answer is based on function signature, and when overloaded function is called an answer. This guy has written, looks at the number, types, and order of arguments. function word. Now, no word is overlapping with the previous one. But the fact that the order, number types and order of arguments is capturing the notion of function signature, this learning has to be. We cannot probably be doing just by extraction of words or some phrases. It's a deeper problem. My objective here was to look into scenarios where this kind of technique makes sense. By no means I am saying that this can assess creative writing. By no means I am saying that this can assess the chemistry, answer script, the process involved in equation, and many other things. It's a very specific use case that I am talking about. Even at this level, I can't solve more than 70% correlation. There are many things that can be done in terms of the traditional pedagogy, how assessment is done in the traditional pedagogy, and that should be done. I am not doing much in terms of activity. I am trying to see kind of identify use cases, for example, in a pattern, in a program like NPTEL. NPTEL is the India's first ever, right? Which is sponsored by the government of India. Where there are lots of small answer assignments that are given. What is the capital of India, right? Even we cannot automatically assess today just because there are like many different ways of writing the capital of India in a sentence. Right? We cannot do that. A lot can be done. And kind of my scope, I have to see that intentionally is the right thing.
Do you have any
pre-trained
models for
pre-trained
kind of
models? I use a pre-trained model which are in general text, generally Google website. You can't have pre-trained models transferring from the subject and subjects are divided into question to question. I mean there are it's not probably that easy.
Use cases where you utilize similarity and AMEX.
Not sure how to follow up in that. Sorry about this.
Thanks a lot, Shourya.